Kıymetli IFS Türkiye müşterileri, katılımcılar, panelistler, konuşmacılar, güzel bir İstanbul sabahından herkese günaydın. Hepiniz IFS Türkiye'ye hoş geldiniz. Aslında IFS Connect Türkiye olarak bugün burada gün boyunca dop dolu konuşmacılar, paneller olacak ama belki de bugünün anlam ve önemine binaen şunu da söyleyebiliriz. Global tarafta teknoloji çok hızlı koşuyor. Biz yavaş mıyız, hızlanmalı mıyız? Aslında gün boyunca bunu konuşacağız. Çünkü IFS markası global anlamda kurumsal iş uygulamaları teknolojileri geliştiren bir numaralı marka ve Türkiye'de de IFS Türkiye ailesi olarak neler yapıyoruz hep birlikte? Şirketleri nasıl daha ileriye teknolojik çözümlerle geliştireceğiz? Bunun üzerine kafa yoracağız, konuşacağız, tartışacağız. Bugünün bir önemi de aslında IFS Türkiye'nin 20. yılı kutlanıyor. O yüzden bir kez daha ayağınıza sağlık. Bugün de bizi yalnız bırakmadığınız için teşekkür ediyoruz. Şimdi günün ajandası yoğun, birçok konuşmacı var dedik, birçok sunum var, panel var dedik. Yaka kartlarınızdan gün boyunca bu konuşmacıları, panelleri, ajandayı takip edebilirsiniz. Bu arada bugünün iki tane de sürprizi var. Bir çekilişimiz olacak. Fuaye alanında bulunan refleks duvarı var. Ve refleks duvarında en yüksek puanı alan kişi gün sonunda Apple AirPods kazanacak. Onu da hatırlatmış olayım. Bir diğer sürpriz de gün içerisinde tüm gün boyunca LinkedIn üzerinden IFS Türkiye'yi etiketleyerek hashtag IFS Connect yazarsanız paylaşım yapan katılımcılarımızdan biri de AirPods kazanacak. LinkedIn'den bu paylaşımı yapanlar diyelim. Şimdi aslında biz burada panellerle, sunumlarla IFS Türkiye'yi size daha iyi anlatma, vizyon nereden nereye geldi, hangi projeler yapılıyor konuşacağız elbette ama fuaye alanında yemek ve kahve aralarında da Erguvan Odası'na girerseniz IFS hakkında daha detaylı bilgiye sahip olabileceğiniz pre-sales ekibi var. Onlarla da tanışabilirsiniz iş çözümleriniz için. Bir de bir küçük bir not daha var bugüne ilişkin. Özellikle Orlando Unleashed etkinliğine gitmeyi planlayanlar varsa aranızda MIT standına uğramanızı da tavsiye ediyoruz, rica ediyoruz. Efendim ben daha fazla lafı uzatmayayım. IFS Connect etkinliğimize bugün aslında çok kıymetli bir katılımcımız da var, katılımcılarımız var daha doğrusu. IFS CEO'su Mark Moffat ve Mark Moffat'la beraber de IFS Avrupa Türkiye Başkanı bizle beraber Andre Roberts olacak. Ben alkışlarla onları sahneye davet ediyorum. I would like to invite IFS CEO Mark Moffat and IFS Europe President Andre Roberts.
Hello,
good
everybody.
Good night in Istanbul.
So, hello, everyone. My name is Andre Roberts. I am the president for Europe, Southwest Europe, and Latin America. And I'm very, very pleased to be joined on stage today by our CEO, Mark Moffat. So, Mark, what an incredible audience, and what a great venue for us to share this fantastic day with you. So, for those who don't know, this is our 20th year anniversary of IFS in Turkey, so welcome to all of you. So, Mark, congratulations.
Good night.
Congratulations on your appointment of CEO, so recently been appointed.
Yeah.
For us, how's it going?
It's going so well. I mean, I've been in role now 5 months. I was with the business for 2 years. We've got such an exciting agenda as an organization. We've got 6,000 customers globally. We're going to reach 2 billion revenue very soon. We're incredibly blessed with a number of really great customers on a global basis. A number of those customers are in this room today. We've got a fabulous business in Turkey that we're enormously proud of. And I couldn't think of a better place to be today than here with you in Istanbul.
I mean, we've done a few of these over the last few months, but I think it's fair to say that this Connect in Turkey, it's the best, isn't it?
100%. And I mean that, seriously. I said to Ergin and the local team last night when I arrived, I hadn't appreciated you know, the level of interest and attendance that we had for this event, and we got over 700 people in this room, and Andre and I were chatting about it. I'm like, this is the biggest Connect event that we have. And I've been to Paris, I've been to Amsterdam, I've been to Riyadh, I've been to Sydney, and ladies and gentlemen, this is the best Connect. Don't tell anyone.
I think we should give a cheer for that. What do you reckon? So should we give a cheer?
Come on.
So listen, everything on everyone's lips, I think, since you've joined us, I think people really want to know, are we in for big change, or what's your vision? What's the plan?
IFS, I guess, at its core, is very, very simple. We focus on a very small number of target industries, six industries. We're extremely customer-obsessed as an organization. We're very disciplined about where we want to compete to win, and we invest massively in the product based upon what you, our customers, and our partners tell us that we need. So our strategy actually is pretty straightforward. And we know it works because we've been delivering 30% growth every year for the last 6 years. And I can tell you, in today's business plan, we plan to grow another 30% for the next 5 years. 30% organic growth. Now, you don't do that as an enterprise application software company on a global scale if you're not doing things right already. And I think the fundamental for us as a global organization is making sure, Andre, as you well know, we listen to our customers. And if we listen to our customers, we listen to our partners, and we respond to what you need, what you ask for, what you enjoy by IFS, we will continue to grow 30% a year. And that is outperforming every single other global enterprise software company on the planet. So the fundamentals are super strong. And like any good strategy, Andre, what we need to do, based on your feedback and based on our understanding of our market, is we need to make sure we respond to what's in front of us. And in that same way, of course, the strategy over the last 12 months has responded to deal with the advent of artificial intelligence and AI. So no different from this year, when we're doubling down on what that means for you, we'll be thinking about what else is happening in our market to keep us relevant, in Turkey, to keep us relevant in the region, and to keep us relevant on a global scale. So fundamentally, no change, because that's what we're going to do.
So what I'm hearing is evolution rather than revolution, right?
100%.
So doubling down on our strategy made us so successful, backed up our world-class service, and continues to be customer-obsessed. I think that's something that you're very well known for.
Yeah, no, of course. And it's something that has been true of IFS for a very, very long time. And I've met a number of customers since joining as CEO in the last 5 months. And as you know, I declared very early on that my intent was to meet 100 customers in 100 days. And that was so illuminating to hear from you, the broader global customer base, about the things that we're doing well, the things that we need to improve on, because we're not perfect. We don't get it right all the time. And we're humble enough to know that we don't get it right all the time. But as a leadership and as a management team here in Turkey, globally, you know, we pride ourselves on being very customer-centric. Every organization on the planet tells you they're customer-centric, but we walk the talk. Andre and I, we spend over 50% of our time with customers every single day. You tell me another CEO of a major global enterprise software company that tells you they spend 50% of time with customers, doesn't happen. That's not just me, that's the whole management team, and we'll continue to do that as we scale as an organization.
And yeah, I mean, like you say, truly, truly global operation, outgrowing the market threefold. So you've met with many customers, your 100 customers in a 100 days journey. What have you learned from some of the other jurisdictions, countries, and demographics where you've been traveling and meeting our customers that we can share with these folks?
It's a great question. And actually, when I said to the organization, I'm going to meet 100 customers in 100 days, it massively backfired on me. Because suddenly, everyone's tracking the number of customers. Like, Mark, where are you? It's day 80. How many customers have you met? And then some customers wrote to me and said, Mark, really interested in the fact that you're meeting 100 customers in 100 days, but I don't see you on my calendar. When are you coming to see me? So I'm going to continue to meet as many customers as I can in the coming weeks and months. But what are they telling me? Different flavors in different markets, but there's a couple of themes. Number one, customers are worried that as we get bigger, as we scale, we lose that customer touch, that customer centricity. It's one of the reasons that I'm so public in declaring that I plan to spend over 50% of my time with customers. The management team do the same. And we're so public on the importance of us listening as an organization and responding. So I'm leaning into that challenge from our customers and making sure they understand what we're doing about it. We will not lose sight of who we are. That's number one. The other theme, perhaps, Andre, coming out is the importance of the partner ecosystem and investing in the partner ecosystem and making sure that they're an integral part of our community. Because in certain markets, I actually think we're stronger in Turkey, in certain markets, the partners are not where we need them to be. And be clear, we view this community, IFS people, our customers, and our partners to all be part of the same community. So we want everyone to feel that they've got an invested interest in what we do as IFS to make you, our customers, and our partners successful. So that theme on partners was another thing that came out on
there. Yeah, and I think in different geographies, we've got different opportunities, right? But I think in IFS Turkey, this is a phenomenal customer base, if you just look around us. So what's your view on the Turkish market and where we're going with IFS Turkey?
I mean, it's a fabulous market for us. I mean, we're in the top two enterprise application software companies in this market. I mean, that's an incredible strength for us, an incredible position. And I think our brand recognition and what we're delivering here has never been better. But that's in large part because of our global reach and our global scale. And one of the benefits this market gets from us here locally is the reach into the 7,000 people that exist in IFS globally, the many thousands of people in our partner ecosystem, and you get direct access to all of that, whether that be a very particular specialist on AI and data in a particular industry, whether it be access to some of our deepest, most experienced solution architects from an integration standpoint, you get access to all of that. So we are incredibly proud of our 20-year history in this market. We're so delighted that we've got about 600 customers here in this market. And I know we've got a number of future customers in this room who hopefully will be inspired to commit their future to IFS. We will not let you down.
Very good. So listen, let's change a little bit track. So we can't have a conversation without speaking about AI.
Yeah.
So last year, I think, was the year of talking the talk around AI. What's your view? Are we going to walk the walk on AI in 2024?
We have to. I mean, the market has spent, I don't know, pick a number, like 10 billion, 100 billion. If you look at investment in hardware as well as services and software, I think the number I saw recently by, I think it was the Financial Times in London, talked about $180 billion of investment that's now gone in through equity, through hardware, through startup funding into AI. And I have not seen, I don't know if a number of people in the room have seen, any massive demonstrable return on investment yet from an enterprise perspective. Plenty of returns from a consumer point of view, but very little from an enterprise perspective. So we have to be, as an industry, as a set of organizations, delivering on that AI promise in 2024. And I believe that IFS has got a great strategy that will help you and us achieve that.
Yeah, and I mean, you speak quite often about how we are really specific in our development of AI.
Yeah.
And I think you talk a little bit every now and then about the 100 use cases.
Correct.
So I think that's definitely something everyone here in this room will be able to get value from. So we talk about AI. As you sort of think about us, the journey we go on, and the rest of our customers, what advice would you give anyone who's going on this AI journey?
The advice I'd give you primarily is make sure, as individuals, in your day-to-day professional life and personal life, use AI. Use the tools you've got available. I consider myself to be pretty technology savvy. But I gave recently my credentials for my premium OpenAI subscription on my phone to my 21-year-old son. And about a week after I gave him my credentials, I went onto my app and I'm scrolling to see what he's been doing. And I'm like, my head was blown with what he was doing from a day-to-day life perspective. And it educated me about how to use AI myself and educated me about what to do in my professional life. So everyone needs to take personal responsibility for using these tools available. This is going to change the world as we know it. I'm utterly convinced about that. From an IFS perspective, you know, Gen AI is just one AI tool. We actually classify our AI capabilities into six different business capabilities. Generative AI and natural language processing is one of those, but there's another five. So in IFS, we have a scheduling and optimization engine, which we've invested in for the last 5 years. And that's natural AI-based machine learning, algorithmic-based capability, often used in the field. So if an organization's got a number of technicians, engineers, this AI capability, which is one of the six, can help you take 25% of your cost out. It's huge. It's significant. And if I may, Andre, you mentioned the 100 use cases. One of the things that we've been really focused on as an organization is not just giving you access to an API through the product. Anyone can do that. You know, that's reselling OpenAI capability. We forced ourselves to think about our industries, and we forced ourselves to think through in the industry, in the context of the industry, what are the challenges? What are the pain points? What are the value processes in that industry? What can we do if we had mass AI and compute available? And we went through a very long process to identify 300 use cases. And we took those 300 use cases and we're like, 100, delete, never gonna happen, or unrealistic, or vapor. And we got that down to 100. And the plan in the next two releases of our product is to make those 100 use cases available, but they're really at the point of need in the workflows of the user community. Specific point of need AI capability in the product made available in the day-to-day operation that, by the way, we can measure from an ROI perspective. No other global enterprise software company that I know of, Andre, does that.
No, I totally agree. And I think one of the things that really sets us apart is this whole theme around composability.
Yeah.
So I know that's something close to you, and you talk again about that quite a bit. So why don't you share with us your view on why that is so important?
Yeah. So this helps a little bit because I'm not a salesman, right? And a lot of my peers leading global enterprise software companies are salespeople. I'm not a salesperson. You know, I've made a career out of listening to customers and responding from a services standpoint. And it's no different in the way I think about composability. So our IFS cloud platform is a single data model, it's a composable architecture, and what that allows us to do is speak to any of our customers and say, hey, what's your problems? What are you trying to solve? You know, what challenges are you trying to overcome? What opportunity exists to modernize your operations to support your business? And what often happens is we start with a problem, we start with a challenge, and we have a conversation about how the particular combination of IFS cloud capabilities can meet your need. And however small that need is, what I say is, thank you. Thank you for your business. Thank you for your trust. It doesn't matter how small that footprint is. I know with confidence we're going to deliver. And if we don't deliver, you're going to tell us. And if you tell us there's a problem, we're going to listen. And when we listen, we fix it. Okay? I can't tell you how many times I've experienced problems, and we adopt that attitude. What happens is customers say thank you. You're listening, you're responding, we want you to do more. And in order to do more, it's easy. We've got this composable architecture. We can say, okay, you've got asset management, you have service management. Do you want some ERP capability as well? Because we've got that too. And we give a customer the picture that they need integrated into the rest of the landscape. Super, super important for us, Andre.
Yeah, I agree. And it's that end-to-end value creation, right? It's something that I think we all stand by, live by, is creating value for each of our customers. So I listened to one of your interviews, one of your many interviews that you had talking about 2024. And I think the person interviewed you asked you, what's your catchphrase or word for 2024. And you picked an interesting one. You picked thread. Do you maybe want to just share how you got to thread and sort of what that means?
Yeah, so I was being interviewed by IDC, and we have IDC with us today, and thank you for joining us, IDC. I think they're moderating a panel a little bit later, and they were interviewed a number of CEOs. And at the front of the interview, the interviewer said, I'm going to ask you for your word of the year. And then I completely forgot. And then we went through the interview, and he said at the end, okay, you've had 1 hour to think about your word of the year. What's your word of the year? And I was like, I have no idea. But I'd been speaking with the head of our research and development the previous day, and we'd been talking about the criticality of data. Now, AI doesn't happen without getting a handle on your data. And everyone in this room will know the importance of getting a handle on your data. And what we were talking about, and it was in the context of these use cases, so we've got a number of customers who identify, build, and operate offshore wind farms. Really, really proud of that customer base. And we're gathering telemetry, time series data from those wind farms. And we're talking about what do we do with that data? And we're basically saying, well, unless you've got that data in the context of other information, in this case, think about, there's only really three or four major manufacturers of wind turbines. If we can get from the OEM their data about the operating protocols and standards for their equipment, and we can conflate that with the data that the customer has, thread of data, then you can develop all sorts of new services, new capabilities, deliver better operational performance, better uptime, lower cost to serve, etc. And what we kind of identified through that discussion, Andre, is just getting a handle of your data and getting the thread of data is so important. So that's thread. But in our architecture for how we're thinking about AI, we're building an AI services layer, we're building an AI data layer, and the intent is that we're going to be able to aggregate lots of third-party data, as well as the data from our customers' solutions that will allow us to deliver you just phenomenal return on your investment in IFS. But data,
very good.
Data and thread.
Very good. So I'm seeing we're almost at standing capacity at the back. So, I mean, thank you for spending time with us. I think it's been a really, really good conversation. You guys agree?
Thank you.
So what I heard is no revolution, but evolution.
Correct.
AI, we're going to walk the walk rather than talk the talk in 2023.
Yeah.
Customer obsession will never go away. It's what we live for. It's part of our DNA. We continue to invest in Turkey to make sure we deliver world-class products to our customers.
Yeah.
And we are one of two, has to be the number one soon, if not already, application service provider in Turkey. So thank you to all of you for investing and trusting us to help deliver value for you as our customers. So one of the biggest things I always think about these events is it's great to listen to all of us on stage, but it's the relationships we all build as we spend today together. So if you see me or Mark first, in the hallway somewhere, it would be great to hear some of your stories. And thank you again for having us today. So thank you very much. Now before I go...
One final word for me too. I just want to thank you personally for all being here. I recognize your time is really, really, really valuable. Thank you for those of you who fought the traffic to get here as well. I faced Istanbul traffic. I know it's no joke some days, but honestly, it's such a privilege that you've taken the time to be with us. We have an aspiration to be the number one enterprise application software company on the planet for asset and service, and you're all going to help us do that. Thank you very much.
Before we go.
Okay, last thing. So before we go, one more thing.
Before we go. So I want to have proof for the world to see that this is the best Connect. So can we take a selfie? Do you all want to wave and go crazy and stand on your chairs?
Come on. Okay, make this count, Andre. Ooh. You need to flip the camera.
Right. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.